You're listening to the worldwide broadcast of the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. The Declaration of Independence was written and signed in 1776, and I don't know many Americans who would not have wished to have had a hand in the preparation and the signing of that document. Well, we missed our chance in 1776, but you can take part in the modern Declaration of Independence, which will take place in Washington, D.C. on September the 29th, 1993 at 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time on the Capitol steps. I encourage you folks to participate in this march on Washington. Join the Declaration of Independence, September 29th, 1993, 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Support Project 93 March on Washington, D.C. Meet on the Capitol steps with, we hope, hundreds of thousands of other American patriots who want to get this country back on the right track. Americans from all over this great land will march on the nation's capital demanding First Amendment rights of redress to present grievances to Congress. Number one, to abolish the unconstitutional Federal Reserve banking system. And number two, to abolish the unconstitutional Internal Revenue Service. This has all been brought about by basically one person. Her name is Devvy Kidd. She is the guiding hand, the everything behind Project 93, and she is our special guest tonight. But before we get in there, I want to just give you, you know, a little bit more on this. We need to reclaim our constitutional rights. Now, if you're not there, if you don't show up in Washington, D.C. on September the 29th, we'll know that you don't really care about your constitutional rights. You see, we're going to have to muster more people in Washington, D.C. on September the 29th than anybody has ever done in the history of this nation in order to make the impact that we need to make. You need to take time off without pay if you have to go. You need to do anything that you have to make sure that you're in Washington, D.C. on September the 29th, 1993. Just think, folks, you can tell your children and grandchildren how you took an active part in taking our country back and making it free again for you, for your children, and for your grandchildren. This is your chance. This is our chance. Let's make the most of it. Devvy Kidd, welcome to the Hour of the Time. Give us some background.
Well, first of all, I think from folks listening to your program, they have a good understanding. But for those folks who might be new and tuning in, many people wonder why the national debt continues to go up instead of go down, despite the bushel barrel trillions of dollars that are poured into the so-called national debt. The reason behind this is the so-called Federal Reserve banking system, which in fact is not part of the federal government, but the courts have ruled that the Federal Reserve banking systems are locally owned and controlled corporations. And if you ask the federal government themselves, and I have a legal status of the Federal Reserve System here by the Congressional Research Library of Congress in 1983 from their law division, as to the question of the legal status of the Federal Reserve as a private organization or governmental entity, and I quote, may well depend upon circumstances in which the question is posed. So this seems a little ambiguous to me when we're talking about an entity that has total control over the monetary system of the United States of America and, in fact, controls every aspect of our lives and that which we slave for. The Federal Reserve banks have attributes both of government instrumentalities and of private organizations. They don't pay any taxes on the money that they're stealing from us, but yet they have never been audited. They don't have to answer to anybody. And when my attorney and I, about approximately 1 week ago, were at the law library, he is a judge but a real patriot, teaches constitutional law, we spent hours going over the Federal Reserve Act of 1913, and the one thing that struck him as being most unconstitutional was the fact that the Federal Reserve, at their own discretion, and this is written into the Act, can tell or report to Congress whatever they choose to tell them at the time. They're only required to report once a year on July 20th, but whatever information they give is solely at their own discretion.
And it doesn't have to be true, really, does it?
It doesn't have to be anything. Now, the 16th Corpus Juris Secundum in the legal sections, known as, or jargon as CJS, under Section 141 says, the Congress cannot delegate their authority to any private corporation, individual, or foreign nation. Now, when these three senators passed this special act by voice vote in 1913 while Congress was out of session, they most certainly violated this section of constitutional law. There is a provision in the law, though, that says that the Congress can delegate certain responsibilities to individuals, corporations, or foreign nations, but it must have standards, it must be fair, and meet other criteria. According to the provisions of the Federal Reserve Act of 1913, absolutely zilch in standards. There's nothing in fairness. The way the act is written, it is simply nothing more than a big, gigantic trust given over to private consortiums of individuals, most of whom aren't even U.S. citizens.
It is, in fact, antitrust, isn't it?
Well, yes, and there's a number of constitutional violations in the act itself.
You know, you said something earlier that's interesting, and I know that people's ears perk up when you say it, because I talk about it an awful lot, and where I know exactly what you're talking about, Devvy, there may be a lot of people out there who don't. You said that when the Federal Reserve steals from us, mm-hmm. Can you explain that?
Well, these three senators in 1913 have violated constitutional law, and the Federal Reserve Act itself is unconstitutional. Therefore, any processes or the mode that they do their business is unconstitutional. So they are stealing money from us by charging this usury on this bogus currency that they issue to us that is deliberately created, laden full of debt out of thin air. It has no value to it. But more importantly, this is how the national debt is created. It is created by the usury that compounds daily on the interest that they have charged the U.S. Treasury, or we the people. As an example, in this little booklet you can order in our packet, I filed a Freedom of Information Act request with the Bureau of Printing and Engraving. And Mr. Ferkler wrote back to me and said, this is how it works. The Federal Reserve comes to the Bureau of Printing and Engraving and for $230, which covers labor and printing and ink and paper, they purchased $10,100 Federal Reserve notes. Now, for that $230 investment, they then place a collateral lien against the U.S. Treasury for the face value of any denomination that's printed, and in this case, it would be $1 million. Now, if you or I, with our own corporation papers, went to the Bureau of Printing and Engraving and tried to purchase $10,100 Federal Reserve notes for $230, we would be arrested for attempting fraud.
Absolutely.
I know that somebody tried that, and that's exactly what happened. So it doesn't matter if this Democratic administration spends a nickel in the next 4 years. The so-called national debt will continue to climb to approximately $12 trillion because of the aggregate usury that compounds every day.
Let's see if we can put this into language that the average person out there who may not understand all this jargon can understand. Isn't it a fact that the money itself never existed? It's created out of thin air.
That's exactly right.
And then this money is loaned to someone, and they are charged an interest which was never created in the first place. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So,
in essence, what we do is rent money from the Federal Reserve.
That's right. And the only thing that keeps the economy afloat at any given time, any given moment, on any given day of any given month or year, is the fact that more money must be constantly lended into circulation to take the place of the money that disappears that's repaid in interest that was never created.
That's right. And someday in the day of reckoning will come, because borrowers are forced to take on increasing amount of debt, not only to pay the principal of the debt, but the erroneous usury as well. And ultimately, in about two more years, the whole thing will collapse because it simply cannot continue to take on the debt that we're taking on. But the bottom line is, we don't have to take on this debt. And I always ask people, why do you want to give all this money, the sweat off your brow, to David Rockefeller or the Rothschilds or any of the other private stockholders? Why do you want to do this? Why are we not standing in the streets demanding that we return to pre-1913, allow our treasury to print debt-free constitutional currency, loan it to banks, have them pay a set interest rate back to the federal government? Now, the Federal Reserve's operating capital is more than $1 trillion a year. If we, the people, or our U.S. Treasury assumed this responsibility again, we would generate triple-digit millions and billions of dollars back to the United States government, which is the way it was intended to constitutionally generate revenue to pay for the Department of Defense and judicial and stuff like that. We don't need to have this banking system that doesn't work.
No, and that's what made this country so successful in its early days, in its beginning, was the fact that we had a real system that worked when the rest of the world was on this phony debit or debt system.
There are several examples. After the War of Independence, this country's economy was prostrated by the severe price inflation that followed emission of the so-called Continental Currency and other worthless bills of credit, or paper money, by the Continental Congress and the states. When the new Congress, operating under our Constitution, passed the Coinage Act of 1792, which created the nation's system of gold and silver coins, a tremendous economic recovery began almost right away. And similarly, after the Civil War, the country's economy was devastated by price inflation resulting from the issuance of these greenbacks, which was another form of paper money that had no real basis to it. So returning to constitutional principles again, Congress passed the Specie Resumption Act of 1875, which redeemed the greenbacks and gold coin, and that again triggered another massive economic upswing that really catapulted America into world leadership. So continuing the way we are is to continue the death of our republic, because this paper system is going to collapse on everybody's head.
Yes, it has to. It would have collapsed a long, long time ago if it were not for the Internal Revenue System. You see, as they keep loaning this money, and as the money is paid back and the interest is paid, it causes currency to disappear from circulation, which always results in what's known as a depression. To prevent that from happening, they keep putting more and more money into circulation in the form of Federal Reserve notes, or what's even worse, issued as credit, where no money is actually even put into circulation, but is used as checks, as credit cards, as this kind of thing, electronic transfers of money. And they keep putting this into circulation either as Federal Reserve notes, which have no worth or backing whatsoever, or as credit. And what that creates is tremendous inflation. The inflation would have been so far out of sight if it had not been for the Federal Reserve pulling money in at the end of each year and putting that back in to pay off the national debt. In fact, when you pay your taxes, when you write out your check and send it in, when it comes back, if you flip it over, you'll see that it says pay to any Federal Reserve Bank in payment of United States obligation. It does not go to the United States Treasury.
Not only that, but one of the other unconstitutional flagrant violations of the Constitution, according to this judge friend of mine, one of the provisions of the Federal Reserve Act of 1913 says that any bank in the United States within 90 days after opening their doors must become a member of the Federal Reserve banking system. And he says this is equivalent to Federal Express one day announcing that the U.S. Post Office and Tiger Express and Overnight Express, when they all must suddenly use Federal Express just because they're called Federal, as the only way to move your overnight mail.
And this is...
This is an form of extortion. In addition to that, the 13th Amendment, the second one, by the way, to the U.S. Constitution, says that Americans cannot be placed into involuntary servitude by forcing us to use their bogus currency that is debt-laden and continues to put us farther and farther into a debt that we can never pay off. Mathematically, this national debt can't even be paid down because of the way the interest compounds every day, so it is a folly to think you can ever pay it off. Therefore, you and I and every other good, decent person in this country are involuntarily placed into servitude to this private cabal of banksters just to line their pockets and make them filthy rich.
That's correct, and I believe that that is the exact manner in which they will coerce the population into accepting their new world economic and totalitarian socialist order.
The propaganda's working. I did a radio show last week, and a young man called in and said that there was absolutely nothing wrong with the new world order. When I tried to explain to him the downsides of it, he just scoffed at it, and I said, have you ever had a problem dealing with the federal government of the United States? How would you like your central government to be located in Berlin or someplace like that? Oh, that will never happen. And I said, I'll bet you believe in the tooth fairy, too. I said, I'll bet you even think that NAFTA is a good idea.
Stevie, you were arguing for no purpose at all, because you can't argue with people like this simply because the point is they're not thinking. And if they're not thinking, they are exactly what the elites say they are. They are cattle. They are sheeple, as I call them. And they don't have the capacity to understand what you're saying until they regain the capacity to have individual, original thought.
Well, they're walking around unconscious. Their eyes are open, but their brains are fried.
That's right. That's absolutely correct.
I didn't argue. I told them to do the same thing I've done. Give up your career at tremendous financial hardship to your family, and you go ahead and buy a couple hundred of these books, and you go to the federal archives like I have and spend literally months worth of our time, and you research all this, and you read publications on a regular basis like Foreign Affairs, and then you come back and tell me that you're ready to lay down and be somebody's dog.
Right. And only then would he even be qualified to argue any point with you on this subject. Most people, I found, argue along lines that they don't understand, but for some reason have been made or coerced into believing on subjects that they know absolutely nothing about. And this is what you call bigotry. This is what you call dogma. This is what you call, there really isn't any other word for it than stupidity. It is absolute stupidity to take a stance on something that you have not studied and know absolutely nothing about. But this happens all the time. I've been encouraging my audience to do what you have done, not to give up their career, because I don't believe that people really have to do that unless they're going to do this full-time like you and I do it full-time. But to be an informed, intelligent American citizen, I think they can hold their job and still do the studying and the research that they need to do. It's going to require them to get away from the television set. It's going to require them to read a book, which a lot of people don't like to do anymore once they've discovered visual tools, and a lot of other things. It's going to require that they don't go down and sit in the local pub and suck up the Budweiser, for a couple hours every day.
Well, if my husband's a retired colonel at the Army, and he's an engineer now, and I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing if it weren't, for him doing that. But it's my firm opinion that it's time to get this over with once and for all. And if you sit and analyze a problem and figure out the quickest, easiest, and most constitutional way to do it, it really isn't that big a deal if we can get enough people to participate and do it the right way.
Well, Dina, you said that the Federal Reserve is not an agency of the United States government, but it's the Federal Reserve. Why isn't it an agency of the United States government?
Well, how fraud is perpetrated by making people believe something that isn't true, so the easiest way for these people to slam this down the American public's throat without them having any suspicions was to call it federal. The Federal Reserve Board of Governors is appointed by the President and confirmed by the Senate. But in actuality, they are not part of this government. They are not answerable to anybody. They have not been audited in their 80-year history, which is the 80 years of since their existence. They do what they want. I mean, they are a dictatorship within themselves, and they have total control over every aspect of the American public's life. And, of course, people say, that we need to have an Internal Revenue Service and pay taxes, and I just look at you know what? These traitors to the Republic of the United States created a way to drain the wealth of the American people. Then they had to figure out a mechanism by which they could collect all of this so-called debt. So they invented the Internal Revenue Service, which, of course, is just part of the Marxist doctrine of creating this heavy progressive tax against the individual, robbing them of their individual accomplishments and achievements and bleeding the nation dry.
Sure, and it's a direct tax, which is unconstitutional.
Yes.
And basically what the IRS does is it does two things. Number one, it fulfills the requirement in the Communist Manifesto of draining the lifeblood from the middle class, which results in its ultimate destruction, and along with this NAFTA treaty is going to happen 1,000 times as fast as it would have had if it had just been the IRS. And number two, it covers up for the tremendous amount of money that doesn't exist that they're pumping into the economy in order to cover up for the fact that they're stealing the interest on all this money that was never created. And the Internal Revenue, sloughing this money off the top,
tends to keep the inflation rate at a level where the public may question it, but they don't panic. Whereas if this did not happen each year, the public would be in full-blown panic, and our inflation would be worse than Germany after the Treaty of Versailles after World War
I. Well, it also accomplishes something else, too, is it continues to keep an entire population of the form of the free world in a state of fear so that they are distracted, they're harried, they're worried, they're afraid, and they aren't able to set aside, you know, the time or the energy to pay attention to the things that are really important. The Internal Revenue Service, by continuing to operate without due process, without proper authority, they have people in this country so afraid that some people won't even sign our petition because they say, the IRS will come after me.
Oh, I have those people, too. They want to order the radio tapes, or they want something that we have to offer, but they don't want to write us a letter. They don't want to put their return address on the letter. They don't want to give us the address where to send it because they're afraid they're going to get on somebody's list. Well, folks, if you're one of those people, I got news for you. There's only one list. There's one list, and you're already on it.
That's right. FinCEN's got everybody's name by now, I'm sure, but it's pretty sad when the mighty Republic of the United States of America has bred generations of sheeple who are afraid to stand up for their rights that's quivering and cowering in their shoes because they're so afraid that some government agency is going to come after them, when all they really have to realize is that the power in this country is in the hands of the people, because the Constitution was created by man, and underneath the Constitution created our government. And so therefore we are at the top of the pecking order here, not our public servants, and it is up to us to legally and peacefully put them in their places instead of cowering and being terrified like a timid little mouse. Most certainly these people play hardball. It's no question in my mind, after watching Waco and Randy Weaver and knowing about individual horror stories, these people are playing for keeps. But if enough people rear up their heads and enforce their constitutional rights against our public servants, our servants, we can effectively put a dent in the March for the New World Order in the United States of America by cutting them off at the knees, which is their big money machine.
Yeah. You know, I hear all the time, I hear these World War II veterans and Korean veterans and Vietnam veterans say, I fought for my country and I'm not scared, and when it comes time to stand up and fight, I'll grab my gun and go fight. And you ask them to sign a petition and they won't sign it because they're afraid they'll get on somebody's list. They're hypocrites and they're liars. And I'll tell you something else. They're the same people who will not stand up in this country on our own soil to protect and defend the Constitution of the United States of America and save this country, but they will pat their kids on the butt and send them off to die in the sands of the Middle East for something that has nothing to do with this country, and it's all based upon misconceptions, false ideas of what patriotism is, and all of these other things. And I, for one, am absolutely sick of it, Devvy. I've got no patience for these people. I call them what they are. I tell it like it is. And because of that, a lot of them don't like me, but that's tough. I'm going to keep throwing it in their face until they wake up.
I get awful tired of it, too. I didn't fight in any wars, but I do understand that what the Monroe Doctrine says in every war we've had since World War II is nothing but an engineered event staged by the world elitists who fund both sides of the fence here to make sure they come out on top while American blood continues to get spoiled in areas where we shouldn't even have our nose stuck into. And like you, I am fed up and sick with people saying that they're good Americans and they're patriots, but yet they will not give up the time to get involved in solving the problem if it means giving up an afternoon at the Rockies baseball game.
Yeah, or taking any personal risk whatsoever. They want you and I to put our head on the chopping block, and if we lose our head, they'll say, see, we told you so.
Well,
if we win, you see, they will enjoy the freedoms that we've saved for them.
Time to take a break, folks. Don't go away. We'll be right back after this very short pause. Well, if you're listening to these broadcasts, folks, you understand just how far down the tubes we've gone. And you also understand that the future doesn't look too bright unless we manage to do something really quick. And that's what this broadcast is all about. It's to wake the sheeple, empower the people, and save freedom, not just for this country, but for the world. You see, the freedom of the rest of the world hinges on our efforts to keep ours. And if we fail, they're all going the way that we go. And that's right down the drain, folks. Have you taken steps to protect everything that you've worked for all your life? Do you even know what it is that throughout history has been the mainstay at preserving wealth of individuals during hard economic times? Well, if you've been listening to Devvy Kidd, and we're not through with this broadcast, I can assure you, then you know that we're expecting a total economic collapse unless we can get Congress to abolish the Federal Reserve, the IRS, and return to constitutional money. That's the only way out. But no matter what happens, we're going to have tremendous fluctuations in the economy on the downside before this is over. And you're going to have to take some kind of step to protect what you have worked all your life to accumulate, to amass. You don't want to see your family living in a ditch. And I can guarantee you, folks, that there's going to be a time coming when a lot of families are going to be thrown right into the ditch unless they take steps to protect themselves. Now, our sponsor, Swiss America Trading, specialize in these kinds of investments. Hard, non-confiscatable, non-reportable assets. So call Swiss America Trading right now at 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. Mention my name, William Cooper, and you'll also get a free newsletter on protecting your future. Call now, 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. By protecting your future, you'll be protecting the future of this broadcast, the hour of the time, and, of course, freedom for the world. Call now, 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. You'll be glad that you did.
You know, I hate to say this. I started off and when I began doing what I'm doing years ago with this great faith in the American people. And I'll tell you, that faith is being eroded rapidly and more and more all the time. They may turn out to be exactly what the elites say they are. They may be cattle that need to be herded and slaughtered. I don't know yet. I haven't made up my mind. I'm still trying.
I think that, you know, because of the wonderful freedoms that we used to enjoy in the United States, people don't really believe that this can happen. They think that this is some sort of conspiracy. And when I do radio, I always tell people, it may have been a conspiracy at one time, but believe me, folks, these...
It's out in the open now. It's
out in the open. They talk about it. On January 7th of this year, when Lawrence Eagleburger was still Secretary of State, he was on C-SPAN giving a speech to the Council on Foreign Relations. He looked right in the camera and he said, things are going so well for the New World Order, we're going to start accelerating some of our programs. 5 weeks later, we had Waco.
That's correct.
That, to me, was an object lesson to prepare people for the coming police state.
That's right.
It's not a conspiracy anymore. It's a business plan, not unlike Xerox or IBM, not to identify them, but like any large corporation would lay out and they decide, well, we're going to do this with this country and we're going to do that, and the end result is that we're going to be at the very top and everybody else is going to be our slaves, and this is how we're going to do it. And they just go ahead and talk about it. We're going to have world government by conquest or consent, and they bought up all the crooks, cowards, and criminals back in our Congress, and they just are twiddling right along here.
Tell us about your organization, Devvy.
Project 93 is not a new club or group or anything. There's no, there's no membership dues that you have to pay. I started it in January by contacting 1,000 people, and I said, look, we know what the problem is. It's time to quit talking about it. We need to figure out a way to get the information to mainstream America and wake them up. And thus I came up with the idea of picketing the Federal Reserve because it has brought tremendous public focus on this entity itself. And I said, well, under our First Amendment rights, we can address our Congress with our list of grievances. Specifically, we want the Federal Reserve audited so we can separate the real debt from all this bogus usury which they can use to wallpaper their bathroom. We want the Federal Reserve abolished so so that the Treasury can assume the legitimate debt and no American will lose anything. Only these elitist banksters will lose their shirt. And we want the IRS abolished because we don't need to have a personal income tax to fund the government. And, you know, an offshoot of that is, you know, I always ask people, how much government do you need is how much money you need to collect in constitutional revenues, such as the Treasury loaning to banks, excise taxes, military sales, things like that. Do we really need the National Endowment for the Arts? Do we need all this pork? No, we don't. There is so many ways that within 5 years you could cut the government down to a very small entity.
Devvy.
Republican government.
Devvy,
you want to stop the pork, take away the money, and then there's no way to fund it.
Yeah, but you know what happens? Let me tell you what I run into when I talk about that on this show. You see, I get letters from everybody saying that the national debt is too big. We owe too much money. Government is too big. There's too much money being spent. Our taxes are too high. So you say, well, let me see. What would you like to cut? There's a military base in your district. Should we transfer those troops somewhere else and get rid of the cost of running that military base? Well, the first thing they say is, oh, no, because we get so much money from in our economy from that military base. Well, let me see now. Entitlements are approximately almost one-third of the entire federal budget. Should we cut back on any of these entitlements? No, because if we do that, then I won't be able to pay my medical bill when I'm 70 years old. And on and on and on and on. The truth is everybody in this country wants every single penny and dime that they can get from the federal government. And if you try to cut back on any of that, they will scream and yell and holler. What they want you to take away from the government is something somewhere else that doesn't affect them.
Well, to a degree, that's true, but I'll get back to that in 1 second. I wanted to finish about Project 93. Constitutionally, only the U.S. Congress has the authority to abolish these two entities. So therefore, we have to go to the House of Representatives, of which there are 435 people. Rockefeller, Kissinger, Briscoe Cross, none of them have the constitutional authority to stand on the House of Representatives and do anything other than talk. These 435 people are the ones we're going after, and we only need 51% of them to pass the legislation. But we're going to go to them and say, look, here is the problem. You've already been given the solution. We have hand-delivered, and you've signed for, a copy of the Monetary Reform Bill that explains how to spend the Federal Reserve notes out of circulation, replace them with constitutional intrinsic currency, and get rid of this debt that we have. If you don't do what we're asking you to do, tens of thousands of us in this country will begin filing commercial liens against you, not common law, but commercial liens. We're going to freeze your signatures. We're going to revoke your servants' bonds, and you will no longer serve in the House of Representatives or the United States Senate because you took an oath to uphold the Constitution, and based on da-da-da-da-da, you have violated that oath, and now we're going to get you out of here, and we're not going to stop. We're not going to fade away, and we're not going to break up and go back into backbiting, backstabbing patriots. We are committed, and we're unified, and we're going to see this through to the end, and we're going to force the issue one way or the other. Now, going back to the taxation thing, people have been so weaned onto the government that they don't understand that the success of America was when the government was the size of an orange and the private sector was the size of a watermelon. What we have to do, and it won't happen overnight, you cannot just take away the airline subsidy overnight. You give them 36 months. There is absolutely no reason why we should subsidize an industry that gives away frequent flyer miles and sponsors things like the Olympics and then turns around and have to suck off the American taxpayer. You either work like a business and you make a profit or you go under. That's free enterprise. Let us look at the income tax that was collected last year, I should say extorted from the American people by this IRS. In 1992, it was $476 billion and some change. Now, if you're paying $350 billion to this phony national debt and you're only collecting $476, obviously the United States of America is not running on the income tax. Now, if you look at the receipts that were collected without the income tax last year, the feds took in $615 billion and some change. They say they needed $1.3 trillion, and that includes this phony national debt. If you get rid of this national debt because we don't need it, Everybody wants a health care program. Let's say that you eliminate Medicare and Medicaid because, number one, they don't work. The only person who's ever benefited from those programs is Ross Perot because his company, EDF, has made triple-digit millions of dollars creating computer programs. But let's say that you really want to have health care reform. Mrs. Clinton wants to slap us with a third layer of health care when we already have two programs that don't work. Not to mention the fact that it's unconstitutional to tax us to pay for this type of thing. So if the country really wants a health care program, let's knock out Medicare and Medicaid. That knocks out $292 billion a year. Let us implement a national health care program that's funded by an excise tax. Right there, between the national debt and knocking out this health care programs that are in effect right now that don't work, you've already knocked out almost $600 billion in expense. And as far as the excise tax for a health care program, I believe that everybody should pay for it if you're going to have it. If you charged 5 cents on a six-pack of Coca-Cola and not any other brand, not Dr. Pepper or anything, just that one brand, it would generate $7.5 million a day. Now multiply that times 352 days a year, add in all the other brands, and you can quickly see that an excise tax that even the poorest person, where there are no personal income tax, would not miss that nickel, and everybody in the United States eventually would probably end up using it in one form or another after their employer's insurance runs out or they retire or whatever. So if it's something that everybody's going to use, make it pay for it in such a way that nobody really can feel the pinch of it.
Well, not only that, but it's a legal tax. A direct tax on individuals in the form of income tax is, in fact, illegal.
What happens if you stop the income tax? The first thing that happens is you infuse our economy in disposable income of $500 billion.
At least.
Now, Mr. Clinton wants us to contribute $30 billion to create 550,000 jobs, most of them government, which continues to perpetuate bureaucracy.
Not only that, but the more people who are working for the government, the less chance you have of ever reducing the size of the government, and they know this, and that's why they've created this huge monster that's out of control.
Well, that's what I mean. So if $30 billion will create 550,000 jobs, what happens when you dump $500 billion into the private sector? You clean out the unemployment lines. Why has America suffered all these massive layoffs besides the insane immigration and free-for-all trade policies? As we the people are taxed and taxed and taxed, our disposable earnings for anything other than necessities have continued to shrink. What's the result of this? Employers have had less and less demand for their goods and services, so they lay off. As Americans try to meet these unjust and immoral tax levels, they need more and more earnings to offset this. And what's the result of this? Higher and higher wages, which drive the cost of it to the consumer farther and farther out of reach. So what you have is the dog chasing his tail syndrome. You're either going to stop the tax, build up the private sector, and slowly, not overnight, but slowly get rid of these government agencies. Remember, as more and more jobs are created in the private sector, which pay better than the government anyway, these people, when you start abolishing some of this government waste, will be absorbed into the private sector. In addition to that, studies have shown that from 25 to 55% of the women who are currently in the workforce would rather stay home and raise tomorrow's society. Today's children are tomorrow's society. They want to stay home. They don't want to entrust this very, very important function to a bunch of strangers. So, once again, these mothers to stay home with their children, and you would again open up millions of jobs to other folks. So the ultimate result of stopping the income tax is nothing but tremendous benefit to America.
That's true. And all this feminism notwithstanding, DV, isn't it true that the only reason that so many women are in the workforce is not because that's where they want to be, but that's where they have to be?
That's exactly right. And I cannot stand these neo-Nazi feminist movement women. I'm in the work I used to be. I don't anymore because I'm doing this, but hopefully I'll have a paying job again someday. I was in the workforce because I was a single mother and I had to work. But my daughter just turned 18 and is going to college. So I would like to work. I don't have to work. We really could make it on my husband's income. But I'd like to work. But my neighbors, these ladies who have children of small school age, they just hate it. Not only that, but I think part of the problem with the family unit and of different sex families, of course, not same sex, but is the fact that when these couples have such tremendous pressure put on them of the woman having to work outside the home and coming home, and people are worn out and marriages are falling apart more and more and more because of these outside pressures that's put on them. If women were able to stay home as they want to do and raise these children, our leaders of tomorrow, I really believe that more marriages would survive also, because a whole lot of the pressure would be taken off the couple themselves.
Well, sure, but one way to destroy the country is to create an inflationary period, which was done in the 70s, that would cause both partners in a marriage to have to be forced to go to work. This puts the children either on the street or in government-controlled daycare centers, where they are then indoctrinated into the New World Order.
Oh, yeah, and I tell you what, these government socialist schools are just turning out generation after generation, number one, of kids who can't read or write, but who have absolutely no moral values, or who are killing themselves as teenagers because they hear one thing at home, you teach them your value, and in my case, you know, we're a Christian family, and then they go to school and tell them that men having sex with men is perfectly normal, and if you don't think it's normal, then psychologically you're flawed.
You know, Devvy, where does this come from? Where does all this press and all this publicity come from that teachers in this country are such great individuals and should be paid more and should be patted on the back for their accomplishments, when in fact they're the most dismal, abject failures of any educational system in the world?
Well, I blame it on the National Educational Association and the participation by the Ford and Rockefeller foundations in the school systems. 2 years ago out in California, the state of California actually rejected, after they received a load of school books from the Rockefeller Foundation, they refused to accept and they refused to pay the bill. Rockefeller took them to court, and the California Supreme Court upheld the California Superintendent of Schools, because their objection was that the school books were such socialistic doctrine that they refused to put them in the schools out there.
The same thing happened here in Arizona. We had one history textbook that had so many errors in it and so many glaring errors that it was just flat rejected, and we began examining other textbooks in our schools and found out that they had rewritten history. They had claimed in this book that Truman solved the Korean conflict with the use of an atomic weapon, and many other things. And you're right, it is all slanted to teach the children socialism, and the state of Arizona got rid of those books also. And I think all of you out there listening who have not been down to read the textbooks in your local school, you better go do it, because if our experience and the experience in California are any indication, you're in for a big surprise.
Well, see, that's what happens, though, when you continue to keep mom and dad in so harried, sitting in traffic. You know, I worked out in the San Francisco Bay Area. My husband was a garrison commander at Oakland Army Base, and we had to commute about 30 miles, which took an hour and a half. And by the time we got home at night, we were absolutely dead tired. I was an admin officer for the Army. But, you know, I had to spend the time with my daughter. I mean, she graduated at the top of her class with a 4.9 grade average in the gifted program. But it takes a lot of work and a lot of commitment. And she didn't start public school until she was in the eighth grade. She was in a private Christian school all that time. But we had to, you know, spend the time. And it's my opinion that if my daughter had not been at the age she is and out of the public school system, I would have taken her out again and put her back in Christian school. I would never have left her in the public school. See, Denver here is an enclave for the sodomites, and they've really pushed the agenda big time here. But a lot of folks are getting fed and sick and just fed up with it. A lot of people are homeschooling out here. An awful lot of them are putting their kids in private school.
Yeah, we homeschool too, and we started our daughter basically when she was born. She's 3 years old, and she can already read. And a lot of people, you know, I ask them if they're teaching their children, and they look at me like I'm crazy because they don't believe that children can learn until they reach a certain age. When in fact, their little brains are just waiting for somebody to teach them anything, and they will learn anything that you will teach them.
I know. Brandy was the same way. When by the time she was three, she could read. But I also attribute her high academic achievement to the fact that my daughter does not watch 2 hours of TV a month.
My daughter doesn't either. Now, I want to tell you folks out there who are listening, I'm not trying to make you think that my daughter is any kind of a genius or anything special or anything better than your children. She's not. What I'm trying to tell you is we started teaching her when she was born, and she can read now because of that, because we spend time with her, and you can hear that Devvy did the same with her daughter, and you can do the same with your children. They don't have to be 5 or 6 years old before they can learn. They can learn anything that you want them to learn anytime that you decide you're going to get off of your butt and teach them. And you better start teaching them, because if you don't teach them, they're going to be taught what the New World Order wants them to know, and they're going to lose their future. And by golly, I'll tell you, if they're going to lose their future, then we're the ones who will suffer the most, because we know what freedom really, really was.
And that's, you know, one of the reasons why I work so hard doing what I'm doing is, you know, so many men and women and children have spilled thousands of gallons of blood to keep this country free, and this is, you know, our responsibility and our job to do everything that we can to ensure that this one nation under God stays a free nation and that we do not fall. And one of the real things that irks me, besides the iron-fisted control by these elitists of the school systems and the media, are the big corporations in this country who continue to cry wolf about things like NAFTA, but yet are members of the Bilderbergers. Bristol-Myers Squibb Company, their director and chief executive officer, Dow Chemical, United Steelworkers of America, the president of the AFL-CIO, the president and chairman of Xerox, the chairman of Archer McDaniels Midland. These people are all members of the Bilderberger elite. They go to Germany and places like that once a year to plan the death of the Republic, and then they have the unmitigated gall to turn around on TV or in the U.S. World and News Today and complain about how NAFTA is going to take away American jobs. Boy, talk about hypocrites.
What about this march in Washington, Devvy?
Well, we're going to be there September 29th. The purpose is to show an overwhelming, unified voice and get in the House of Representatives' face and tell them, look, this many people now know the truth about the Federal Reserve and its handmaid in the IRS. We know about your ultimate goal of the New World Order. And we are telling you that if you don't do what is constitutionally right, we're not asking you to do something illegal, then we're going to get in your face and we're going to have you removed from office and we're not going to stop. But they're not going to pay attention to 1,000 people standing in front of the House. But they'll certainly sit up and take notice if there's 250 or 300,000 people with petitions in their hands.
Well, that's it, Devvy. We're out of time. I want to thank you for being our very special guest tonight, and I want to thank you for all the work that you've done to try to get this out to the American people, to make them understand what's wrong with the Federal Reserve and the Internal Revenue Service, and, of course, for your Project 93 March on Washington, D.C. Everybody write this down. September the 29th, 1993. September 29th, 1993. All of you gather, meet all together on the Capitol steps in Washington, D.C., 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Folks, Americans from all over this great land are going to march from the nation's capital demanding First Amendment rights to redress to present grievances to Congress to abolish the unconstitutional Federal Reserve banking system and abolish the unconstitutional Internal Revenue Service, which imposes a direct tax on the individual, which is against the Constitution, and many, many other things. So, for information, send $5. Send $5 for information to Project 93, 14253 West Baltic Avenue. That's 14253 West Baltic Avenue, Lakewood, Colorado, 80228. One more time, Project 93, 14253 West Baltic Avenue, Lakewood, Colorado, 80228. Or you can call 303-969-9639. That's 303-969-9639. Good night, folks, and God bless each and every single one of you.